My name is Shruti Verma, and in this video lecture, we will basically discuss one of the most important threats evidence, that is class. So, there might be several questions are arising in your mind, like what is threat evidence, why is it that class is one of the most important threat evidence, and how is it useful for forensic purpose, and how can we conduct the examination of this class evidence, etc. So, in order to get the answers of your questions with a very detailed and an expressive explanation, kindly watch the video till the end. So, before starting this session, firstly take a look over the content of this session.
So, we start this session from the definition of trace evidence. After this, we will move to the core topic of this session, that is glass. So, in glass, we start from the definition of glass. Then the chemical composition of glass, after this the types of glass fractures, then the marks found at the edges of glass sheet, and then we will discuss the collection, preservation and packaging of glass evidence, then the forensic examination of glass, then the instruments used for glass examination, and at last we will discuss the forensic significance of glass evidence. Okay, so now let's start this session, and in this, firstly, what is trace evidence? So basically, trace evidence refers to the evidence which is transferred from person or place. In forensic science, this concept is termed as Locard's principle of exchange, as it states that every contact leaves a trace because it is impossible for you to go anywhere and come back without leaving your presence at that place. So, we can understand this statement with the help of an example, like even if you touch anything or any object, you will leave your fingerprints on that particular object. Okay. So, there are several types of trace evidences, like hair, fiber, paint, soil, glass, fingerprints, footprints, tire marks, track marks, biological body fluids, etc. And in this session, we will basically focus on glass evidence, as glass is found in almost every type of crime cases in various forms, like window pane, window of car, glass for drinking any liquid, shattered particle of glass from any broken object, etc. And with the help of the glass, we can determine so many important information to solve a particular crime case, so that we can say that glass is one of the most important trace evidence. Okay. Now let us move to the next slide, and here is what is glass. So basically, glass is a hard, brittle and an amorphous substance which is composed of sand mixed with various metal oxides melted at very high temperature and then cooled to a rigid condition without crystallization. The product is termed as glass. Technically, we can say that glass is an inorganic product of fusion which has cooled at a rigid condition, and in a very easy language, we can understand that glass is a crystalline supercooled liquid. So, this is the basic definition of glass. Okay, so now let's move ahead, and here is the chemical composition of glass. So, in this, basically glass formed from four types of oxides, in which first one is network forming oxides, second one is network loosening oxide, third one is stabilizing oxides, and fourth one is intermediate oxides. So, let us firstly understand what is network forming oxides. So, network forming oxides, also termed as formers, because it forms the main network, or we can say the basic network of glass sheet, and these types of oxides are sulfur dioxide, germanium dioxide, etc. Now let us move to the next, and here is a network loosening oxides. So network loosening oxides, also termed as modifiers, because it modifies the quality of glass evidence, as it is used for reducing the melting point of glass, and these oxides are like calcium oxides, magnesium oxide, barium oxide and lithium dioxide, etc. Then the third one is stabilizing oxides. So these are the also termed as modifiers, because it used for reducing the adaptability of glass in regards to hydrolysis. And there are these oxides are like calcium oxide, magnesium oxide and barium oxide. Then the last one is intermediate oxides. So these are both, that is formers as well as modifiers, and These types of oxides especially used in special types of glasses, and these types of oxides are lead oxide, beryllium oxide and titanium dioxide, etc. So, on the basis of the chemical composition of this, we have the different types of glasses, like by mixing different chemicals, or we can say different oxides in different ratio, we have several types of glasses. Like here, you can see that there are several types of glasses, in which first one is laminated glass, tempered glass, soda lime glass, borosilicate glass, aluminosilicate glass, lead alkali silicate glass, light sensitive glass and silica glass. Okay, so here is some of the types of glasses. Now let us move ahead, and here are the types of glass fractures. So basically, there are four types of glass fractures, in which first one is a radial fracture, second one is concentric fracture, third one is cone fracture, and the fourth one is fracture due to heat. So now let us understand all these types of fractures with the help of the diagrams. So here is the first image, and in this image you can see that here is a glass sheet in which a blunt object hits in this particular place. So we can identify that the particular object is hits in this place, because all the fractures is originate from this particular point. So that is why we can say that the projectile hits on the glass sheet at this particular place. Okay, so in this you can see basically two types of fractures, that is radial, and the second one is concentric fracture. So the fractures which are originate in this form, like which are radiate outwards from the point of impact, these are termed as radial fractures. Okay, and these types of fractures basically originate on just opposite surface of the point of impact, or we can say the external surface of the point of impact. Okay, so we can understand this also with the help of an image, but before this we can understand the concentric fracture. What is concentric fractures? So concentric fractures are those fractures which are in circles the particular point of impact. So here you can see the circular pattern lines, circular patterned fractures. These are the type of concentric fractures. Okay, so here are both radial, lines that are radiate outwards from the point of impact, and the concentric fractures which encircles the point of impact. Okay, so now let us move ahead, and here are the next image, and in this you can understand how a glass fracture is, the proper mechanism of a glass fracture. Okay, so here you can see that this is a particular glass sheet, and in this here a particular projectile hits the glass sheet. So here in this particular point where projectile hit, compression is applied, and it's just opposite surface of the glass, here is a tension is applied. Okay, so with the help of this you can understand that compression and tension is applied on just opposite surfaces of a particular glass sheet, and the two tensions on a particular glass sheet, or we can say two compressions applied on just a diagonal to each other like this, in which this is the tension and it's just a diagonal, here is the other tension, and it's opposite, there is the another tension which is just diagonal to each other. So here first tension, second and the third one, just diagonal to each other. And similarly in case of a compression, like this, first one, second compression and the third. Okay, so in this pattern both the compression and tensions applied just opposite side, and two tensions or two compressions applied just diagonal to each other. So in this case glass fractures, when the compression or tension, or we can say the velocity of particular projectile reaches the elasticity limit of glass, or we can say cross the elasticity limit of glass. So in this image you can see that here the projectile crosses the elasticity limit of glass and breaks the particular glass and forms a hole in there, in this position. Okay, so here you can see that the radial fractures, here is the radial fracture, and in radial fractures the opposite surface is breaks first, and opposite surface is also termed as external surface, and the surface on which the point of impact is termed as internal surface. Okay, So here you can see that this is the radial fracture in which the opposite surface breaks first, and here in concentric fracture you can see that the point of impact of projectile surface is breaks first in concentric fracture, or we can say in concentric fracture internal surface breaks first and in radial fractures the external surface breaks first. Okay, so this is the proper mechanism how a glass fractures. Okay, so now let us move ahead, and here is the other image, and here you can understand that how a cone fracture look like. So here you can see that in this particular position a projectile hits in this glass sheet, so here a cone like fracture pattern form. So here you can see that there is a radial fractures which are radiate outwards from the point of impact, and the fractures which encircles the point of impact is termed as concentric fractures. And in the central position where a particular projectile hits is termed as a cone fracture, because it forms a cone like pattern, because in this the exit side is wider in comparison to entry side. Entry hole is smaller in comparison to exit hole. Okay, so this forms a cone like pattern, and this is also very useful for the determination of angle of projectile hits, and also for the side on which the projectile hit to the particular glass sheet. Okay, so this is overall of the radial fracture, concentric fracture and the cone fracture. Okay, so now let us move ahead, and here are the fourth type of fracture, and this one is a fracture due to heat. So in this case there you can see that several random and wavy lines are present inside of this surface, and these lines are move outward from the point of contact of heat. Okay, so this is the fracture due to heat, and this kind of fracture generally found in arson cases, and these types of fractures is also completely different from radial and concentric fracture because it does not follow any type of particular pattern just like radial and concentric fracture. Okay, so this is the overall of the all types of glass fractures, and now let us move ahead, and here are the several marks found at the edges of glass sheet. So basically there are two types of marks which are present at the edges of glass sheet, in which first one is rib marks and the second one is hackle marks. So now let us try to understand these types of marks with the help of the diagrams. So here in this image you will understand what are rib marks. So you can see in this image that there are the curved lines is present at the vertical side of the glass sheet, or we can say at the edge of a glass sheet. These types of marks are rib marks, and you can also see that these rib marks forms perpendicular to one side and forms a tangent to the other side. So the rib marks forms perpendicular to that surface which breaks first, and as I told you before this, that in case of radial marks the surface which is just opposite to the side of impact is breaks first. So that is why here is the point of impact, this is the side of impact or surface, and this is just opposite surface, so that why this surface breaks first, and this surface bears a perpendicular rib marks, and this is the surface of impact, so that it bears a tangent rib mark. Okay, so now here is a concentric fracture, and in concentric fracture the side of impact is breaks first, so that here is this is the side of impact, and this breaks first, this side breaks first, so that this side bears a perpendicular rib marks, and this is just opposite side, so that is why this side bears a tangent rib marks. Okay, or we can also say that in case of radial fractures the rib marks present at the external surface, or we can say the reverse side, reverse side bears the rib marks which are perpendicular, or we can say right angle to the external surface. Okay, so now this is the overall of the rib mark. Now let us understand what is hackle marks. So in this image you can see that the red lines which is present in between the rib marks are termed as Haeckel marks. So these Haeckel marks are formed due to the high energy friction takes place between between two glass sides, resulting some indented lines appear on the vertical side of a glass sheet. So basically, these Haeckel marks formed due to friction, which when two glass slides makes a friction due to any high impact of energy. Okay, so this is the Haeckel marks like this form. Okay, now let us move ahead, and here is the 3R rule that indicates radial cracks from right angle on reverse side, so that it is basically useful to memorize on which side rib mark form perpendicular and on which side rib marks form a tangent in a radial and a concentric fracture. So this formula basically useful for memorizing the perpendicular and tangent side in concentric and radial fractures. Okay.
So now let's understand the proper procedure of collection of glass evidences. Okay, so before starting the procedure of collection, firstly you have to properly barricade the entire crime scene, and after completing the process of note taking, photography and the sketching etc., you have to start the procedure of collection. So during collection, you have to firstly identify the external and internal surface of the particular glass sheet and properly note down that which side is external and which side is internal, and after this you have to collect the glass evidence. Okay, and all the glass evidence should be collected very carefully so that no any extra marks should be formed over this particular glass. Okay, and several types of glass may also contain several types of latent and visible print. So before collecting the glass, firstly you have to lift that particular fingerprints. Okay, and after this you have to collect that particular glass evidence. And apart from this, there are clothes and shoes and other belongings of a culprit or victim may also contain the micro traces of glass evidence. So you have to also collect that particular belongings. Okay, and the tires of cars, or we can say the tires of vehicles, may also contain the shattered particles, or we can say very minute particles of glass evidences. So you have to also examine, or we can say also analyze that the tire marks of that particular vehicle. Okay, so after completing all these types of procedure, or we can say after completing all the collection of all the glass evidences which you can see by naked eyes, after this you have to use vacuum cleaner with filter for collecting all the types of evidences which should not be, or we can say which you cannot see by naked eyes. So all the micro traces should be collected by using the vacuum cleaner. Okay, so now let's understand how can we preserve the glass evidence. Okay, so for very minute particles of glass evidences, we can use small pill boxes or any plastic bottle or poly ziplock bag. Okay, for pointed edges of glass evidence, you should use modeling clay at that particular pointed edge for proper preservation of the glass evidence. Okay, and for very large particles of glass evidence, you have to firstly wrap that particular glass sheet with the help of the cotton, and then properly pack it in the cardboard box. Okay, so after completing the process of collection, you have to properly pack all the evidences by using different boxes, which is completely depend upon the requirement of that particular glass evidence, and then wrap it with the help of the white clean cloth, and after this you have to properly seal that particular evidence by using the wax seal, and this wax seal also contains the impression mark of the investigating officer's seal, and after this you have to write all the important information which is relevant to that particular case over this particular evidence. Okay,
now let's moving ahead. So here is a forensic examination of glass. So here are some of the characteristic features on which basis we can examine the particular glass evidence. So here, First one is physical matching. So in case of physical matching, suppose if this is the broken particle of glass and this is the another broken particle of glass, so you have to physically check that this particular particle is completely fits in this place or not. So if this is the broken particle and this particle is completely fits in this place like this, so you can say that this is the these both particles are from similar origin. If this particle does not completely fits in this place, so you can say that these both particles are from different origin. Okay, then the next one is color. So there are several there are different colors are available of glasses in market, so you have to identify the color of the glass, and this you can identify visually by naked eyes. You can easily identify the color of the glass evidence. Then the next one is thickness. So thickness is generally measured by vernier calipers, and the different glass having different thickness. So this is also a very useful tool, or we can say very useful characteristic feature on which we can identify a glass evidence. Okay, then the next one is texture or design. So there are different textures are available, like some are glazed glass, some are partially glazed glass, some are patterned blazing glass, and some are plain glass, etc. So you have to also identify, also examine the texture and design of the particular glass sheet. Okay, then the next one is hardness. So there are different glasses having different hardness, so you have to also examine the hardness of the glass evidence. Then the next one is curvature. So glass having different glasses having various curves, like some are concave, some are convex. For example, the headlights of car having also having a curve. So you have to examine the curvature of the glass evidence which you have collect from a crime scene, and on the basis of this you have to identify, you have to compare the standard and question sample. Okay, then the next one is density. So density is the individual characteristic feature of the glass evidence, as it is examined, as it is compare, it is determined by comparing the standard and question sample, and this you have to done by using the density gradient test method. Okay, then the next one is refractive index. So in case of refractive index, it is also the individual characteristic feature of a glass evidence, and it is examined by comparing standard and question sample by using the refractive index test method. Okay, then the next one is dispersion. So in case of a refractive index is similar, so that case dispersion is analyzed in standard and question sample. So for this you have to use a chemical, that is methyl salicylate, and by dropping different wavelengths over this particular glass sample. Okay, and at last here is the microscopic examination. So microscopic examination of glass is also very important, because sometimes the glass carry very minute traces of other foreign materials, like it may be very minute particles of blood, very minute traces of soil, cement, dust, etc. So to find out these types of foreign material which are very minute particles which is present on glass evidence, so you have to examine glass under the microscope. Okay, so now let's move to the next slide, and here is some of the important physical examination, in which first one is examination of fracture, then the second one examination of marks found at the edges of glass sheet, and the last one is other biological or foreign material examination. So all these three types of examination is most important to examine the glass evidence, and we will understand all these of types of examination in forensic significance. All these types of examination, its usefulness, we will also discuss in the forensic significance of glass. Okay, so now let's move to the next slide, and here is some of the instruments which are used for the examination of glass evidence. So here are some of the instruments, in which first one is UV rays, then fluorescence spectroscopy, then emission spectrophotometer, neutron activation analysis, flameless atomic absorption spectrophotometer, X-ray fluorescence, photoluminescence, spark source class spectrophotometer, And the last one is scanning electron microscope equipped with NAD dispersive X-ray analyzer. So these are some of the instruments which are useful for the examination of glass evidence, because with the help of these we can determine the trace elements, trace metals which are present in glass, and we can compare the standard and question sample very easily. So that is why these instruments are very useful for the examination of glass evidence. Okay. So now let's moving ahead, and this is the last topic of this session. So this is the forensic significance of glass evidence. So there are basically some of the important characteristics, or we can say some of the important informations which we can determine with the help of the glass evidence. So here, first one is angle of impact, then the number of projectiles, sequence of holes, and types of projectile used, velocity of firing, or we can say velocity of the particular projectile, then the distance of firing, or we can say the distance of projectile with which it hits to the particular glass evidence. Okay, then the next one is direction of force and the fracture due to heat. So all these types of informations are determined by the examination of types of fractures and the marks found at the edges of a glass sheet. So that is why the types of fractures and the marks at the edges of a glass sheet is very useful to determine, to examine very thoroughly, so that we can determine these types of very useful information, and with the help of these types of information we can solve a particular crime case very easily. Okay, so now let's moving ahead, and here is an image. So with the help of this image you can easily examine, you can easily determine the sequence of holes. So if you imagine that this is the one hole and this is the second hole, so here you can see that in this you can see that these radial fractures is reaching to the end of the this particular glass sheet, but here you can see that these are reaching to the ending of this glass sheet, but these are restricted by the radial fractures of this one. Okay, so in this case you can easily identify that this one is the first projectile hit to the particular first hole, or we can say the first hole in this glass sheet, and this one is the second hole in this particular glass sheet. Okay, now let's moving to the next slide, and here are some other important informations which are determined with the help of the examination of glass. So in this, first one is impression marks. So sometimes impression marks is also present on the glass sheet, so its examination is also very useful, and impression marks like fingerprints, footprints, etc. Okay, then the second one is trace evidences, then the types of marks, types of fractures. So types of marks and types of fracture we already discussed in the previous slides, and the next one is link culprit or victim to the scene. So glass is also very useful for linking culprit to the victim, or for linking crime scene to the case, and also for the determination of actual crime scene. So that is why in that case glass is a very useful important trace evidence, and with the help of this we can determine so many types of important informations.
So that's all for today's session, and I hope that you all understand this topic very well, and at last, thank you so much for joining me here.